guests. Welcome to the American Society for Engineering Education's 126th Annual Conference and Exposition. Please take your seats and direct your attention to the stage at this time. We are also happy to welcome our virtual live stream viewers.
Good morning. My name is Jeffrey Steiger, and I am creative director of Florida International University Odd Theater and artistic director of a theater, the New Theater of Medicine in Washington, D.C., both theaters that are based upon the idea that theater might be able to be used or applied to create dialogue. I was asked last year to create a production about the 125 years in engineering education, a production about the history of engineering education. And this year, we're very pleased and proud to present to you the 126th year of the history of engineering education, a theatrical production that we created through interviews, including an astronaut from Apollo 14, engineer historians, and several of you who are in the audience today. Our production begins in the same place that ASEE began, which is 1893, the World's Columbia's Exposition, which was this marvel, a pivotal moment in American history where people could experience the future. Now, folks met the very first washing machine here. 533 square feet on the frontage of Lake Michigan. On everyone's minds were class tensions, industrial growth, and immigration. It was a very different time. The crowd, opening day, 1893, October 9th, they set a record of 751,000 people in attendance. There were so many people that they were hanging from the actual balconies. Folks were everywhere and anywhere. They were in window ledges and on rooftops. There was a palpable anticipation that hung in the air. Finally, after the many speakers, President Cleveland approached the speaker platform, and the crowd went silent.
I am here today to join my fellow citizens surrounded by the stupendous results of American enterprise and activity. We, who believe that popular education and the stimulation of the best impulses of our citizens leads the way to the unparalleled advancement and wonderful accomplishments of a young nation.
President Cleveland's hand rested on this large ivory and gold key, and then as he pressed down, the fair was open and everything turned on. 100 snow-white doves were released and circled up over the waters. A cannon shot sent them back over the administration building, and then 100,000 incandescent lamps turned on, powered by 12,000 horsepower AC polyphase generators. Lights came up on the agricultural building, the technology building, the lights building, the women's building. Science and nature and archaeology all combining in this new marvel, making it seem to those in attendance that the future might be here now. And then finally, the Ferris wheel, the simple but complex design that pretended the role of the engineer. And with the engineer, then two central questions. What should we teach the new engineers and how? So it was here, just a few miles away, ASEE, at the time called Society for the Promotion of Engineering Education, that Charles Bonney welcomed everyone to the first meeting. They kept copious notes, including who didn't have their paper done on time. Burr did finally read his paper. 30 pages called The Ideal Engineer. He ended with a critique of the critique he expected.
It may be, and probably will be, objected that this ideal is too ideal. But such an objection is groundless. The ideal is already too nearly accomplished. Again, aside from such consideration, it is well to remember that that which is not the object of effort is never attained.
The history of women, represented by a series of letters between presidents and deans in 1917. Dear Sir, a committee of the faculty of the Town Scientific School of the University of Pennsylvania is considering the advisability of admitting women students to the various courses, namely the engineering courses. If your institution has had experience with women as students in these courses, we would very much appreciate receiving a brief statement in regards to your experiences. Signed, Dean John Fraser. March 13th, 1917, a reply.
Dear sir, replying to your favor of November 8th, I have to say that I can best answer your inquiry by the familiar phrase in two words. Nothing doing. Perhaps this would be too blunt and might appear discourteous, so I'll add that I have never yet met a woman who wants to be
an engineer. La 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 dee 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 dee.
Didn't suppose there was anything in motorboard or steel reinforcements or bending moments, testing machines, or least squares that would appeal to the fair sex. So with us, the question is not even academic. We never even thought of it. I suppose that we're behind the times. Having a woman suffragist, ladies are too busy with Red Cross ambulance and hospital service and other vital questions to give attention to such vagaries. I think this answers your inquiries. You're very truly Robert Fletcher, Thayer School of Engineering.
Dear sir, I beg to acknowledge the receipt of your letter of November 13th in reply to mine of the 8th in reference to the matter of admitting women students to the Town Scientific School of the University of Pennsylvania. Very truly yours, Dean John Fraser. November 24th, 1917, a reply.
How we doing, Tampa Bay? All right, let's bring it down. Dear sir, since the establishment of the University of California, it has been a law that women are eligible to all classes. Though they have had this right, it is a fact that very few women elect courses in engineering. You ask for my personal judgment. From my experience of 25 years, I should not encourage women to become engineers. Positions open to them are restricted in character, usually being limited to office work. It is a fact that women cannot contribute to the more heroic efforts of engineering endeavor. Dean Derelith, University of California.
Dear sir, I beg to acknowledge the receipt of your letter of November 13th in reply to mine of the 8th in reference to the matter of admitting women students to the Town Scientific School of the University of Pennsylvania. Very truly yours, Dean John Fraser. November 9th, 1917, a reply.
My dear Mr. Fraser, now as to the advisability of admitting women, I think that is a question that will have to be settled by the colleges themselves. It does not seem to me that the women cannot be provided for exactly along the same lines as men expecting. A mere teaching, there must be a differentiation in regards to the abilities. The question of sex must be met. That last line was written in pen with an exclamation point. Alex E. Humphreys, president.
The presence of women increases the complications in some directions.
Curbs some of the freedom or licenses for students and language
as long
behavior.
As she behaves properly.
A flirt will undoubtedly neglect
the presence of a woman
properly.
A flirt will undoubtedly neglect a flirt
properly.
And can't be dropped.
As long as she behaves properly.
126th National Convention and Exposition, Tampa Convention Center, Tampa, Florida, June 17th, 2019. Dear deans,
program coordinators,
chair,
engineering management, administrators, consultants,
graduates,
editors,
directors,
secretaries,
secretary,
and all others.
Recommendation letters for tenure and promotion that say warm, supportive, and my wife really enjoys her.
Why are you in this class? A question in reference to women engineers.
Imagine the letter responses if the inquiry was about admitting students of color.
12%.
9%.
11%.
Lack of mentoring or hostility from potential mentors.
Search processes that just check boxes.
A lot has changed. But I beg to acknowledge the receipt of your letter in reference to the matter.
But I beg to acknowledge the receipt of your letter in reference to the matter.
But I beg to acknowledge the receipt of your letter in reference to the matter.
Man reports. To question anew the pedagogic solutions of 50 years ago, out of a very clear sense that
the load upon the student has become continually heavier. There's a widespread feeling that under this pressure, the great body of students fail to gain satisfactory grounding in the fundamental sciences and do not fulfill the expectations of engineers and manufacturers in dealing with the practical problems.
And then the Wickedon Report in 1930. Presented engineering as a compromise between academic and professional study proposed reducing technical specialization at the undergraduate level and requiring some liberal studies. And then, as if on cue, there was war.
Experiences in World War II accelerated changes that were already taking place. Focus on mathematical modeling and theory increased when engineers generally did not perform as well as physicists in solving unusual problems. Establishment of the National Science Foundation and the government's overall support for research in engineering radically transformed education. Some engineering schools became more selective in recruiting the students who were able to succeed in a more science-based and research-oriented classroom. In May 1952, S.C. Hollister, the president of the American Society for Engineering Education, appointed a committee on evaluation of engineering education chaired by Professor L.E. Grinter. Charge of the committee was to recommend changes in engineering education that might keep pace with the rapid developments in science and technology. Further accelerating the pace was the intercultural political shock caused by Sputnik. Suddenly, the United States was behind. And humans hurled into space with questions to follow.
I saw something out there.
When I return to Earth?
When an astronaut returns to Earth?
He or she is put into a transition room.
A place to wait to get their sea legs back.
Get your vitals checked.
Whatever else they can think to check for.
I had just returned to Earth and... I think we need to sit with that sentence for a moment. I had just returned to Earth.
I had just returned to Earth.
Había regresado a la Tierra.
전 방금 지구로 돌아왔습니다.
I had just returned to Earth. And I was slumped on a chair. My head down. My hands on my face, and the doctors, the psychiatrists, they all gathered around me, concerned.
What are you feeling?
What's wrong?
How are you feeling?
Why is your head down?
Why aren't you speaking?
Can you hear us?
Stop! I wanted it all to stop. I wanted it to be quiet for a moment, just so that it could last as long as it could. I had just seen the Earth authentically, actually, physically, in reality, 238,000 miles away. There. The imagination and the team that made this all possible.
Is the same imagination that could make colonization possible.
The imagination that built houses, family,
malls, houses,
technology,
societies. I saw something out there. Space, time, us.
The Walker Report, the last directed report out of ASEE. The study represented an attempt to indicate in broad and general terms the direction which engineering education must take to meet the demand of the future. Reactions to the Walker Report can best be summed up by a Jewish proverb. A rabbi is not doing his or her job unless the congregation wants to kick him or her out of town. Walker was doing an excellent job as a rabbi in that case. Folks were incredibly upset. The perspectives were different. Walker was concerned about the impending future and the increasing rate of technology. There was fractions. Walker asked, are we science-driven or about providing engineers with skills to solve practical problems? It was the start of a contradiction in dynamics that spread out into the 80s, which we have our roots in now. Folks ask themselves, well, are we actually increasing at a positive exponential rate? Maybe we are. Environmentalists could see damage from a distance because they had titanium screws to climb higher. Universities had models that were working, and folks were saying, yeah, but I don't know if they'll work here. Generally, people were behind diversity, but folks weren't really sure how to do it. And so, here we found ourselves with these contradictions and roots growing that Burr's letter comes back into the 80s and the 90s.
It may be and probably will be objected that this ideal is too ideal. But such an objection is groundless. The ideal is already too nearly accomplished. Again, aside from such consideration, it is well to remember that that which is not the object of effort is never attained.
morning, class.
Generation Y, millennials, mosaics, heroes, next generation, nexters, second wave of boomers, 9/11, war on terror, Columbine, World Trade Center. Tattoos been chic, many boys earrings, and retro is our style. We are non-linear, digitally competent, rapid hand-eye coordination, mental ability to make connection, organize information. Postmodern bias towards non-linear modes, more image stimulational, conquer the modes of thinking. We must think quickly, reinvent the wheel.
Reinvent the
swing back and forth. Another way.
Design is good, but how do we teach it?
Open doors to take. I think it is good. It's so good.
Tech is good.
Yeah, it's good.
We didn't know Cold War. We don't have landlines. Always made popcorn in a bag. Computer, Twitters, MP3s, PDAs, DVDs, iPad, Facebook, friends, the waste, texting, real TV. Computer, Twitters, MP3s, PDAs, DVDs, iPad, Facebook, friends, the waste, texting, real TV.
According to Wikipedia, the world has been born in the past 100 years and all its proceedings.
iPad, Facebook, friends, the
scientific and engineering knowledge presently doubles every 10 years.
Unanticipated technologies are popping
up. The engineer of 2020 will need to be conversant with and embrace a whole realm of new technologies and learn new technical information and techniques.
All the challenges will demand new attention, maybe new technology.
Neglect might move them from problem to crisis.
Natural resource and environmental concerns will continue to frame our world's challenges.
More than ever, engineers will need to understand how to work in teams to be more effective and
understand.
See.
Recognize.
Social issues.
Meanwhile, some old problems are not going to go away. Engineering should look like America.
If you can't see them, you can't be them.
Everything
is so
over the syllabus, I have two questions that I need an answer for. What do you need to learn, and how should I teach you?
Welcome. ASEE, the only society that addresses issues spanning all engineering disciplines, providing that crucial link in the network of engineering education. A leader in the national conversations on engineering aspects of STEM education, engineering and technology workforce, and student retention at the collegiate level. Welcome to 166 years at the heart of engineering education and the 2040 World Columbian Exposition. It was 20 years ago that conversations started. How do we find that balance? How do we find that ideal engineer? How do we combine all the various seemingly disparate elements? The conversations began here 20 years ago. And we're pleased here at the World Columbian Exposition, much like that dishwasher or going to the moon, to present to you what they discovered as the answer. Behind this curtain, exactly, how to prepare the new engineer with their professional skills, how to help them collaborate with other disciplines, and how to focus on meeting human desires and needs. Ladies and gentlemen, what Picasso saw, what an engineer saw when she looked at the moon, and Bach.
I just want to say briefly, thank you very much for your attention and for being such a wonderful audience. This production was created, as I said, out of research and a lot of work and time from folks who are also in this room. We present at Florida International University. We create theater about tenure and promotion, equity and tenure and promotion, interactive theater about search processes and bystander intervention. We hope that our production here today helped create some questions or dialogue as you move forward in the conference. Thank you very much, and thank you to ASEE.
Thank you.
Make sure you check out the member appreciation booth in the exhibit hall. Stop by and you can pick up for free exclusive 125th anniversary logo items while supplies last. You can even take part in the raffle where the grand prize giveaway is free hotel and registration for the 2020 ASEE Annual Conference in Montreal. And while we're talking about appreciating our members, let me remind you of our Renew for Two promotion. Stop by our info kiosk, and if you renew your membership for 2 years, we'll give you 22% off the total price. In fact, there's great stuff in and around the exhibit hall all week. Be on the lookout for free food and drink, and of course, remember the a la mode. Our amazing members often ask, how can I get involved with ASEE? Well, we've now created a member volunteer portal, which you can find at volunteer.asee.org. At this site, you'll be put in touch with leaders at the division, section, and campus rep level, so you can find out about ways to engage. Plus, you can read testimonials about how ASEE has made a professional difference to some of your peers. For 125 years, ASEE's members have been instrumental in shaping engineering and engineering technology education. It's your commitment and passion that allow our society to thrive. Thank you for volunteering.
Guests, please welcome to the stage Mayor of Tampa, Jane Castor.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Tampa, the American Society for Engineering Education. Thank you so much for choosing Tampa for your 126th conference. And I hope it's not 126 years before you come back again. If you guys out there are thinking that I'm like 7 foot tall, they have a little step up here. So I'm actually only 6 foot tall. I'm not nearly as tall. Somebody told me one day in the grocery store, they said, you look awfully tall in here. I said, you ought to see me out in the parking lot. But anyway, this is the greatest city in the nation, in our opinion. So we thank you. I apologize. I always take the weather personal. For those of you who got in here yesterday, apologize for the afternoon rain showers. That's pretty much our summer here. And we are working on the outdoor air conditioning, so we may need some engineering assistance with that. So if any of you guys have a forte, we would appreciate it. But we have so much for you to enjoy here in our city. And hopefully we have just about, I believe we have 7,000 engineering students out at the University of South Florida. Go Bulls. I hope a lot of them are here today. Yes, we got some up front. All right. And because of USF, we are one of the leading cities for patents in the United States as well. We also lead the state of Florida in STEM job openings. So a lot of you that have come here for this conference, you may never have to go home again because there are job openings right here in our city. So we welcome you all. I hope that you have a wonderful conference here. If there's anything at all that you need, feel free. I used to be the chief of police, so I have a little bit of pull right there. And feel free to stop any of our officers, and they will help you with anything that you need. We have historic neighborhoods down in Ybor City. You can go down there and go to Columbia Restaurant that was established in 1905. It is the oldest restaurant in the city of Tampa. They have an incredible salad. I'll forewarn you that you have to, whoever eats it, everyone in the group has to eat it because it's loaded with garlic. But it is amazing. We are the home of the best Cuban sandwich in the United States, and you can stop at just about any restaurant and get one of those. So we have a lot of the Riverwalk out here. We have a lot of amenities that you can enjoy. I hope you enjoy. We just started the e-scooter, and we've had that for about a week, and we've already had over 50,000 rides on those. So they're a lot of fun to go out and ride around. A little bit of an administrative nightmare, but they are a lot of fun, to say the least. But we consider ourselves a very innovative city. And at the end of my tenure, I was just elected mayor a couple of months ago. And I said at the end of my tenure, I wanted Tampa to be seen as the innovation hub of the nation. And just one of the things that shows a little bit of the diversity and our commitment to innovation, the Tampa Bay area was the birthplace of both commercial aviation and death metal. So we've pretty much got it covered. Whatever you need, we've got it here. But we thank you so much for visiting our city. I have passed an ordinance since taking office as the mayor, and that is an additional security step you'll have to go through at the airport. I will expect that you spend every single penny that you have brought to this city to help our economy. So there will be an extra search at the airport to ensure that you take no money out of our community. But thank you all so much for choosing Tampa. And again, please, please, please don't make it another 126 years before you come back. Thank you all. Have a great conference.
Guests, please welcome to the stage ASEE President Stephanie Farrell.
Fellow ASEE members, guests, friends, and engineering educators, I have the great honor of opening ASEE's 126th Annual Conference and Exposition today as your president. Today is the true kickoff of our conference. The American Society for Engineering Education would like to acknowledge the indigenous history of the state of Florida and recognize the Seminole Tribe of Florida and the Miccosukee Indian Tribe of Florida across the state. Tampa is a city of great history and culture, and it's important to understand the history of indigenous people in the city and the state, and to honor those native people who came before us and those who are still with us. Tampa's name is derived from what in Calusa, one native language, was called Tampa, believed to mean sticks of fire, in reference to the area's abundant lightning strikes. The Manasota culture is the earliest documented group to inhabit the land around Tampa Bay. There were several chiefdoms in this area, including Tocobaga and Pohoy, known for building ceremonial temple mounds within their villages. All of the tribes around Tampa Bay disappeared in the 1700s, largely decimated by disease brought by European explorers. The Tampa Bay area was essentially uninhabited for a period of time in the 1700s until bands of peace-seeking indigenous people migrated from the north and settled in Florida. From these different groups of Native Americans, as well as free blacks and escaped slaves, the Seminole emerged. Then, during a series of bitter conflicts in the 1800s, more than 3,000 Seminoles were captured and removed, forced to make the journey known as the Trail of Tears to the designated Indian territory west of the Mississippi. Only about 200 Seminole eluded capture and remained here in Florida. hiding in the swamplands. The descendants of those determined people are today's Seminole Tribe of Florida and the Miccosukee Indian Tribe of Florida. Seminole and Miccosukee have worked hard to maintain financial independence and to preserve their culture. I hope you have a chance to learn more about the indigenous population in Tampa during your stay here. As we kick off ASCE 2019, we are indeed charged up for the next 125 years. Many of you have been in town a day or two, and I hope you enjoyed last night our division mixer and the night before the wonderful Taste of Tampa. I've already caught up with several longtime friends. Notice that I say longtime friends and not old friends so that I can keep them a little bit longer. I'm sure you have also. Thank you so much to Jeffrey Steiger and his troupe for entertaining us once again. Last year, we were treated to a wonderful dramatic representation of ASCE's founding years, and today we got to explore engineering education's evolution in the 20th century. I want to briefly touch on activities of the last year. This spring, ASCE had its second annual Connected Conference, drawing about 300 people to the DC region for a meeting on diversity in engineering and computer science education. We had the inaugural Engineering Communications Conference with over 100 staffers from communications offices coming together for a two-day program to talk about how we communicate about what we do. Our headquarters webinar series continues to grow with an expanding library for you to access. The Dean's Diversity Initiative has evolved into the ASCE Diversity Recognition Program, where we will publicly recognize those engineering and engineering technology colleges that make significant, measurable progress in increasing diversity, inclusion, and degree attainment outcomes of their programs. We continue to be a trusted partner of the federal government, managing numerous fellowships and internships. And members of ASCE's board and senior headquarters staffers travel to section and zone meetings in an ongoing effort to keep connected to you. We brought information with us, but more importantly, we gave you a chance to talk and share your feedback with us. We continue to be strong financially, thanks to careful stewardship of our resources by headquarters staff and our volunteer leaders. This brings me to an important item for the near future. I'm pleased to announce that one way our member engagement will improve is with a new website and digital platform in the shape of a revamped association management system. Many of you interact with the ASCE website, whether it be to find information or to do your research, submit a paper, find a colleague, or other information. The ASCE board has authorized significant funds over the next several years to upgrade our systems, which will improve digital member engagement and make headquarters staff more efficient and our products more robust. A newly hired CIO is overseeing this project, which is underway. In conclusion, thank you again for entrusting me as your president. Our society has been an important part of my entire professional life, and it has been an honor serving you. I look forward to working with my successor, Stephanie Adams, this year. Thank you. And now I'm happy to present the ASCE President's Award. This award recognizes those organizations that make the best use of print, broadcast, or electronic media to encourage K through 12 students to enter engineering schools and pursue engineering careers and or influence public opinion and create recognition of the critical role engineering plays in society. The 2019 winner of this award is Purdue's Inspire Research Institute for Pre-College Engineering Program for its Engineering Gift Guide. This annual publication increases awareness of the many toys, games, and books that exist to promote engineering thinking and design and are fun for both boys and girls. It also shares Inspire's research finding with people who have or work with children. To accept the award are Monica Cardella and Elizabeth Gajic. Please join me in welcoming them to the stage. Before we continue, I'd like to give a heartfelt thanks to ASCE's sponsors, who you will now see on our screens. We thank them for their support in making this event a success. Please hold your applause until the end. At the host level, the University of Florida and the University of South Florida. At the visionary level, ABET, Engineering Unleashed, and the University of Maryland. At the innovator level, McGraw-Hill Education, NCEES. At the pioneer level, Boeing, Dassault Systems, MathWorks, and STM Microelectronics. At the mentor level, Texas Instruments and North Carolina State University. At the leader level, Cal Poly Pomona, University of Miami College of Engineering. And at the educator level, SAE International, Keysight Technologies, and National Instruments. Please join me in thanking our sponsors. ASCE is happy to...
Stephanie. Hi. How are you? Hi, everybody.
Hi, Nathan. Everyone, it's Nathan Call, Communications Director.
Hold your applause, please. Thank you.
Kind of in the middle.
No, sorry. So I've got a really big announcement to make, and so I thought I'd just take a second. Sorry, but no, stay up there. So our annual conference switches cities every year, as you all know. We've got some great cities coming up. Next year's Montreal. Then we've got Long Beach, Minneapolis, Baltimore, and so I'm here to talk about the 2025 location, which I just found out about a few minutes ago. And you know, since I'm interrupting you, it must be a big deal. So everybody, in 2025, ASCE will be
in the great, wow! This is gonna be so fantastic. I know everybody's gonna be really, it's really exciting.
Hey, it's Norman Fortenberry, everybody. Norman, I haven't actually told them yet.
Why not? I mean, what, okay.
You had a cue, you missed it.
All right. Right.
Try not to notice that Norman and I accidentally wore matching suits today, by the way. Sorry about that. So, where was I? Last year was Salt Lake. Most of you were in Salt Lake. Beautiful Tampa this year. Next year's Montreal. Have you been to Montreal?
Ooh, Montreal.
Yeah.
Yes.
Poutine. I hear they have poutine there. Have you had poutine?
Delicious.
I think you're lying. What do you have for breakfast?
The vegetarian.
What do you have for breakfast today? okay, so folks, I don't want to keep you waiting any longer. In 2025, ASCE is going to be in the...
Yay! Isn't this wonderful? This is just going to be so great.
So Norman, he missed rehearsal. He's very busy. Not quite there yet.
Not yet?
Not yet.
Oh, sorry.
all right. Do you have any guesses? Here, how about this? Sunglasses.
Someplace sunny?
Sunny, warm.
Florida.
Not Florida, not Florida again. Florida's wonderful, but not Florida.
No, maybe someplace out west?
You're getting warmer. Okay, west, way west. In 2025, we are going to be in Hawaii. Everybody, thank you. We'll see you in Hawaii in 6 years. All right, bye.
And as I was saying,
so it's gonna be Hawaii! Woo! Hawaii! Yeah. Oh.
Thanks, Norman.
Oh, okay.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Norman. As I was saying, ASCE is happy to welcome the winners of National STEM Focus Contest for high school and undergraduate students. Our first team is CERO of Lone Star State College and their EVA zip tie cutter, a safe and reliable zip tie cutter to be used during spacewalks.
We're Team CERO from Lone Star Sci-Fair, and we won the Future Innovators Award with ASCE.
My team is winning the Future Innovators Award for our project on the EVA zip tie cutter. This tool will be used to repair the alpha magnetic spectrometer on the International Space Station in 2019.
It's important because the electromagnetic spectrometer has a lot of zip ties on the exterior, and there was previously no way to extract those without creating debris that could be harmful to the space station or other satellites.
NASA's really concerned with micro debris in orbit, and cutting off a bunch of zip ties and just releasing them would be bad. It can cause micrometeorites that interfere with later missions. It can cause a lot of damage despite being very small. So they needed a tool that would cut and secure the zip ties and prevent them from getting loose. So that's what we designed for them.
We knew that we had something special when we were designing it. We knew we had something special when it was tested. But we never thought it would actually go to the space station and fly.
We do know NASA is planning on using it. They're taking it up in the second half of June to be used on the ISS for maintenance, which is just really exciting. We never thought it would make it this far. It's been a miracle.
We're so excited to be here in Tampa for this conference. Our team had an amazing opportunity to be part of MicroGenex Challenge, and it's really been life-changing for all of us.
Please join me in honoring Maria Gonzalez, Daniel Vashek, Francesca Liso, Sean Palmer, and James Philippi. Their advisors are Dr. Yen Wang and Professor Jared Kamen. Next is the Race to Zero team of Prairie View A&M and their project, the Fly Flat, Net Zero Energy Affordable Housing for Low-Income Community.
Our team is PV Motswad. We're from Prairie View A&M University, and we won the 2018 DOE Race to Zero Award. We won the award for designing net zero affordable housing for a low-income community. We've been working with a low-income community, Independence Heights, in Houston, Texas, for a couple of years. And most recently, with Hurricane Harvey, there was a lot of damage and flooding in a lot of vacant lots. And so we designed housing that would make little pocket communities within that neighborhood. It would be affordable for the community that is low income, and it would be net zero.
We built a sustainable and affordable house for a neighborhood in Houston. It's called Independence Heights. And it was a cause, or it was a reflection of the Hurricane Harvey. So we wanted to build a sustainable house that could withstand hurricanes and flooding. Our fly flat structure, the structure that actually goes over your house, was engineered, and we actually worked with the engineer to help design that and our HVAC system.
It's a really great honor to be here at ASCE. This is important to our team and all of us because it affected us personally. A lot of our team members are from this community. A lot of our families have gone through similar situations, come from low-income areas, and so being able to use our education to help people that are going through this and using it to do what we want to do in the future, which is work with different areas of this nature, public interest design, sustainable building, was just really important to all of us.
Please join me in honoring Shannon Martin, Shelby Skinner, and their advisors are Shelley Potdorf, Shannon Bryant, and April Ward. Next, congratulations to the winners of ASCE's own EE in 25 video contest, sponsored by our partner, Engineering Cast, by Liaison. We asked student teams to tell us what engineering education would look like in 25 years. Please welcome to the stage University of South Florida students, Zachariah Beasley and Sadhu Mocha.
I'm here with the USF Innovatables, and we won the Engineering Education in 25 Years video contest. And so it's a 90-second video on the way that education will be 25 years from now, and we spoke about different technologies that will be leveraged in different teaching techniques. We talked about distributed learning, asynchronous teaching and learning. We also talked about virtual keyboards and machines. And we spoke about electronic portfolios that track your work through all years of your college.
The video we make summarizes how the education will be in 25 years, like how you can pick your own classes, and it's not a set of curriculum, but you can pick your own classes, and you can take classes online from anywhere in the world, and your portfolio can be centralized, and the companies can look up your resume online.
It's important to look to the future and really think about the way that we can leverage new technologies to effectively teach the next generations, and particularly for me, because I want to be a professor in the next few years when I graduate with my PhD. It's important for me to start thinking about these things.
It's really important for me because I don't want the future generations to have the same set of problems that I had when I was doing engineering education. Yeah.
Here to present them with their $3,000 award is Ron Hyman, Executive Director of Engineering CAS.
Guests, please, another round of applause for our wonderful Student STEM winners.
At this point, I'd like to take a moment to recognize those organizations with whom ASCE has a memorandum of understanding. I'd like to, as representatives from these organizations who are here with us today, to stand, if you are able. the African Engineering Education Association, the Canadian Engineering Association, the Chinese Society for Engineering Education, the Federation of Lebanese Engineers, the Council of Engineering and Technology of India, the International Federation of Engineering Education Societies, the International Society for Engineering Pedagogy, the Japanese Society for Engineering Education, the Korean Society for Engineering Education, the Latin American and Caribbean Consortium of Engineering Institutions, and the European Society for Engineering Education. We are excited to have Engineering Unleashed as one of our sponsors this year. To provide us with a brief overview of this online community for engineering faculty, please join me in welcoming to the stage the recipient of the 2019 Keen Rising Star Award, Amy Trowbridge from Arizona State University.
Thank you, Stephanie. I am honored and excited to talk about EngineeringUnleashed.com, which is an online community that's been extremely useful to me and my peers at Arizona State University, as well as more than 1,500 other engineering faculty, including many of you in the audience probably, across nearly 200 colleges. The tools on Engineering Unleashed have helped me and my colleagues to learn new tools and techniques to help inspire entrepreneurially minded learning, development of a new or a different mindset in our students. It has also helped us to share some of our own successful ideas with others, and most importantly, it's helped us to connect with other engineering educators with similar interests and passions for teaching the next generation. To help you better understand how this community could be useful to you, check out this quick video. I hope to connect with each of you on this fantastic platform.
A professor signed up for Engineering Unleashed. With a name and a picture, her profile complete. She signed up and connected with a colleague she knows through a click and a follow. Let's see where this goes. You see, she wanted to breathe life into each new semester, to teach students a mindset to face trials, change the future. And here, effective educators and community online are sharing best practices she could start using in no time. There are papers and projects and modules on cards about ideation, Ohm's Law, and spinach leaf hearts. Perhaps she will share. Perhaps she'll write this down. This curious idea she's been mulling around. Now a new group of educators, colleagues, and teachers will find the groundbreaking methods of this newest thought leader. The lessons she's learned are impacting others who teach and giving her students the mindset they seek. All because a professor signed up for Engineering Unleashed.
Thank you again to Engineering Unleashed for being a visionary sponsor of our annual conference. Don't forget to join the ASEE subnet on engineeringunleashed.com to engage with content, presenters, and colleagues you meet here, and to continue the conversation. Every year, ASEE elects a new class of fellows. The grade of fellow is one of unusual professional distinction conferred by the board of directors upon an ASEE member with outstanding and extraordinary qualifications and experience in engineering or engineering technology education or an allied field, and ASEE contributions. Please hold your applause while I read this year's group of nominees. Nominees, please stand as you are able. Lisa Benson of Clemson University, Angela Bielefeld of the University of Colorado Boulder, Lisa Bullard of North Carolina State University, Ann Christie of Ohio State University, John Falconer of the University of Colorado Boulder, Joseph Herkert of North Carolina State University, Milo Koretsky of Oregon State University, Julie Martin of Clemson University, Anne McKenna of Arizona State University. Please join me in honoring our colleagues. Speaking of valued ASEE members, we'd like to take a moment to honor someone with us today. This person has been an ASEE member since 1979. He received both the Frederick J. Berger Award and James H. McGraw Award from the Society. And after retiring from St. Louis Community College, he went on to serve the engineering education community as an ASEE staff member starting in January 2013. He retires this fall as Managing Director of Professional Services and Director of External Affairs. He has held every professional and administrative collegiate position from instructor to chief academic officer. He did not know we were going to do this today, so please join me in welcoming a red-faced Ashok Agarwal to the stage right now.
Oh God, I hope you see it.
Ashok is not the only remarkable ASEE staffer. I want to share with you a short video of the various talents of that your headquarters staff have.
Gorgeous day in Rhode Island. And I'm just chilling, riding my unicycle.
All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players.
Now to our keynote speaker. Emily Boyd is a teaching professor and the director of undergraduate studies for the Department of Mechanical Engineering and Materials Science at Washington University in St. Louis. Since joining WashU in 2015, Dr. Boyd has dedicated herself to supporting students and improving the work environment for non-tenure track or professional track faculty. She's the director of the WashU Summer Engineering Fellowship and an undergraduate research runs an undergraduate research program for underrepresented minorities. She co-leads the Women in Engineering program, and in 2017 founded the Women and Engineering Leadership Society for undergraduate students and alumni. Dr. Boyd oversees a student alumni mentoring program, Mentor Collective. As co-president of WashU's Association for Teaching, Research, and Practice Faculty, Dr. Boyd has led policy and cultural improvements for professional track faculty at the school and university levels. She serves as faculty advisor to WashU's ASME and SWE student chapters. She's a member of ASEE and has been an active ASME volunteer for over a decade. Dr. Boyd's technical area of expertise is in thermal fluid sciences, which she enjoys teaching to undergraduate and graduate students using team-based learning. She is a recipient of the 2018 Emerson Award for Excellence in Teaching. Dr. Boyd received her PhD in mechanical engineering from the University of Texas, Austin in 2014, where she researched film cooling technology to improve the efficiency of gas turbine engines. She received her bachelor's and master's in mechanical engineering from the University of Missouri, Columbia in 2006 and 2008, respectively. Please join me in welcoming her to the stage.
Thank you for the introduction, Stephanie, and good morning. Today, I'm speaking about non-tenure track faculty, or what ASCE prefers to call professional track faculty, because we should be defined by what we are, not by what we are not. Throughout my talk today, I'm going to continue to use this term, professional track faculty. I'm here because professional track faculty are a growing portion of the professoriate, who often experience less than ideal workplace cultures and policies that prevent them from thriving in their jobs. It's my privilege to speak to you today as someone who has helped lead change at Washington University in St. Louis by forming a collective voice for professional track faculty. This has transformed the James McKelvey School of Engineering from an average place for professional track faculty to work to one of the best. Changes are needed because the number of faculty on the professional track have increased over the last 40 years. This figure shows the trends in academic labor force from 1975 to 2015, focusing on faculty. You can see the percentage of tenure track faculty in the blue, part-time professional track faculty in red, and full-time professional track faculty in the pink. And clearly, as you can see, the percentage of faculty on the tenure track has been decreasing. Now, you might look at this figure and say, oh no, we're hiring fewer tenure track faculty today than we were in 1975. That's not actually the case. It's just the growth in the number of professional track faculty has outpaced the growth of tenure track faculty. If we look at the numbers as they stand today, there are two things that I would like you to remember. One, that professional track faculty make up more than one-third of full-time faculty positions in the U.S. And two, part-time professional track faculty make up almost half of faculty positions. These numbers are staggering. A fundamental mission of a university is to educate students, and what these numbers are showing us is that professional track faculty are doing much, if not even possibly the majority of it. However, our academic structure and policies haven't kept up with a changing higher education model that is increasingly relying on professional track faculty to teach students. Professional track faculty are often treated as second class as opposed to equal partners in educating students. And this makes it difficult for them to fully love and thrive in their jobs. Our work is sometimes considered less important or maybe easier. And it's presumed that we weren't good enough to get a tenure track position, or that we're just of lower quality. And therefore, professional track faculty are not compensated as well. Full-time professional track faculty earn 26% less, and part-time professional track faculty earn 64% less per hour than tenure track faculty. We often lack funding for resources, such as for professional development, paid leave, benefits, insurance, and much more often aren't commensurate with what tenure track faculty receive. We often lack representation on faculty governance bodies on the departmental, school, and university level. This is a problem because it affects our attitudes towards our jobs and our employers, and professional track faculty can't give 100% to their jobs if they're not fully integrated and informed. People pursue professional track faculty positions for a variety of reasons. It could be the classic two-body problem, where someone is trying to find a position in the same city as his or her spouse, and they need to be a little bit more flexible with the jobs they take. It could be the desire to not go through the tenure process and having to earn that, and they want to lead a more balanced life. Or maybe it's because the person just really likes teaching and wants to spend more of his or her time interacting with students. Over the years, I've had a very similar conversation over and over. Sometimes it's with someone that I haven't seen in a while. Sometimes it's with someone I'm meeting for the first time. The conversation gravitates towards my career. I explain that I teach at Washington University in St. Louis. The person says, oh, well, what are you researching? And then I explain that I'm in a teaching position and I don't do as much research anymore. And then the person is trying to be helpful, but they basically tell me that I need to quit my job, get out of my career, and into a tenure track faculty position as soon as possible before I ruin my career. Sometimes a person tells me that the university is wronging me because I'm tenure track quality and I deserve to be on the tenure track. As you can imagine, this is a frustrating conversation to have because I take what I do very seriously and I think I do important work. And when people are saying these things to me, it's inherently saying that either they don't value what I do or at least that academia in general doesn't value what I do. So now I'm about to tell a little bit more about my personal story to provide an example of what it's like to be on the professional track. If you're in the audience thinking, oh, the professional track faculty at my school do not experience this, I'm here to tell you that especially if you work at a research university, they probably do. Unfortunately, my experiences are in no way unique. Admittedly, when I first started as a principal lecturer at Washington University in St. Louis, which is a highly selective private university, I was hesitant to take a job off the tenure track. I pursued a PhD at the University of Texas Austin in mechanical engineering because I wanted to go into industry. I thought that one day I was going to work for this cool company, work my way up the corporate ranks, and maybe one day manage an R&D division. That's where I wanted to go, that's where I thought I was going. But I met and married my husband, who had strong roots in St. Louis, and when I started looking at jobs there, there were fewer given my qualifications than I'd hoped. So I expanded my job search to include academic positions. My research didn't really fit with the research thrusts at Washington University, but they did offer me a full-time teaching position. I viewed taking the position as a huge risk. I was concerned that the tenure track faculty wouldn't acknowledge me, that they wouldn't appreciate what I was doing, and that I would be prevented from contributing in any other way outside of the classroom. Because I really wanted the ability to advise student organizations, and I wanted to be able to serve on committees that would help make the university a better place. I took the position thinking that a year from then, I could be in a different career. I started the job at WashU, and thankfully, my colleagues did treat me with respect. And I generally liked most of the people I was working with, which speaks volumes. And while WashU is an exceptionally wonderful place, there were a series of archaic policies and cultural norms that prevented me from feeling comfortable with my career choice. When I started, I didn't receive an orientation. I didn't even have a conversation with HR, so everything that I learned about my benefits was from a search on your university website. And now I'm going to admit something really embarrassing. I was 2 years into my position before I realized where my title fit within the teaching faculty ranks. I started as a principal lecturer, and I thought that the senior lecturer title was above mine, and 2 years into my job, I found out that it was the reverse, and that I had been at the highest level of teaching rank that existed at the time. Now, the teaching faculty ranks were listed in a brief policy, but I didn't know the policy existed, and it wasn't in a place where I ever could have found it. I wasn't invited to faculty meetings, so I didn't know what was going on in my department. I wasn't allowed to participate in the school or university faculty senates, so I didn't know what was going on there either. And then there were a few small things. So for instance, on our departmental website, there was a web page for faculty, meaning tenure track faculty. And then there was a separate web page for other faculty. And I was on the other faculty web page. About 2 years into my position, I decided to have a second child. As a professional track faculty member, I did not have access to paid parental leave. Yet, I was in this weird place because I was also considered a faculty member, so I didn't have vacation time. So I timed my pregnancy so that the baby would arrive over the summer so that I wouldn't lose any of my salary. And I would guess I'm probably not the only person in this room who has done that. When you're working at a place that's continuously telling you that you're on the B team in one way or another, it's really hard for you to feel good about your job. And for the first couple years, I really had this feeling that I had settled in my career, which was an awful feeling to have considering I spent 8 years in graduate school. So I recognized that our school and university had all these problems, and I was fortunate that our leadership did as well. In 2017, we accomplished something critical to making the university a better place for professional track faculty. We formed a collective voice. We united professional track faculty on the school and university levels to advocate for change. That year, our school went through a strategic planning process. I was one of two professional track faculty members asked to join the strategic planning committee, and I was specifically asked to chair a subcommittee to address the culture for professional track faculty in our school. This gave us a collective voice on the school level. As part of our work, we did a little fact-finding, and we found out that 26% of our full-time faculty were on the professional track. This is slightly less than the one-third national average that I mentioned before, and we calculated that the full-time professional track faculty were teaching 48% of the student hours, where the student hours are the number of course credits multiplied by the number of students in the course. This is a strong value proposition because if we weren't there, who would teach all those classes? Next, we hosted a town hall where we invited all the professional track faculty members in the school to kind of voice their issues and concerns, because I knew what my issues were, but I didn't know what the issues were for other professional track faculty members, especially the people in other departments. So we used this town hall to figure out what issues we had in common and also which ones are different. Because if you ever do this, you'll find out that issues vary from department to department because departments have their own specific cultures. And we put all of our issues into a white paper, and then we listed a set of recommendations for how to address those issues. If you'd like to see the white paper, it's on our school's website, and I'll show a URL at the end. At the same time, we're finalizing this white paper. A union was on our campus trying to unionize the full-time professional track faculty members. 2 years prior, our part-time professional track faculty had been unionized. So the threat of the full-time professional track faculty unionizing as well was pretty real. To address some of the professional track faculty issues without unionizing, we formed the Association of Teaching, Research, and Practice Faculty, which we lovingly gave the name ATRAP. So, is this a coincidence? Maybe not. This gave us a collective voice on the university level. At this time, we had a perfect storm for making important policy changes. We had supportive administration on all levels. We had the fact that our school was going through a strategic planning process, looking to make changes anyway. There was a union trying to unionize us, and we had the school-wide advocacy through ATRAP. And combining all of these things produced results. So over the next couple of slides, I'm going to show you the changes that our school and university have made over the last 2 years. On this slide, I'm going to talk about the changes we made on the departmental and school level. I'm going to talk about the policy as it was before, and then the policy that we have now. And some of these aren't policies per se, but they're cultural issues. But before, some people were invited to faculty meetings, but not all. And we certainly were not allowed to participate in the school or university faculty senates. Right now, all of us go to faculty meetings, and we're talking about full-time professional track faculty. And we have voting rights on the school and university faculty senates. Before, some of us had annual performance reviews, but many of us didn't, and the process was very inconsistent department to department. Now we have a consistent process for annual performance reviews for all full-time professional track faculty. Before, we were not allowed to do any domain research. This stems from a historical context where our school was sued several decades ago because essentially professional track faculty were doing teaching and research the same job as a tenure track faculty member. And so ever since that lawsuit, our professional track faculty roles were very unbundled. You were either teaching or you were research, but you weren't both. And of course, as engineers, this kind of rubbed a lot of us the wrong way. Now we're allowed to do domain research if it's assigned as a portion of our effort. So for instance, you could be 80% teaching, 20% research. Before, when we had openings for full-time professional track faculty positions, we wouldn't always do nationwide searches. A lot of times we would just rely on luck. I mean, that's kind of how I got there. Now we do nationwide searches to make sure that we're getting the best people. Before, I mentioned that we had that inconsistent listing of faculty on our web pages. Now all of the faculty are listed on the same web page for each department, and it doesn't even designate who's on which track. And I mentioned that there was that vague policy I couldn't find that explained the teaching faculty ranks. And in that policy, there were no promotion procedures. It was very vague. And now we do have a policy that defines the ranks and the responsibilities for each of those ranks, and also promotion procedures. Now I'm going to go over some changes that were made on the university level. So this was in a large part due to the contribution of ATRAP. Before, I mentioned we didn't have paid parental leave. Now we have a whole semester, which is commensurate with what tenure track faculty receive. In fact, it's just one and the same policy. All full-time faculty get a semester of paid parental leave. Before, professional development was paid by departments only, and it was very ad hoc. It depended on what department you're in by what you would receive. Now we have the Provost Professional Development Fund, which provides $1,000 to each professional track faculty member annually. And this is supposed to be on top of what your department would already be paying for, not replacing it. Before, the highest rank was a senior lecturer at the university level and principal lecturer at the school level. Now we have the addition of the teaching professor title to make it the position a little bit more prestigious. And this didn't really apply to engineering, but it was such a big deal on our campus, I wanted to mention it here. The School of Arts and Sciences had a minimum salary of $40,000 for an academic year, and we were able to raise that to $50,000. And that was a pretty big deal for a lot of the professional track faculty who are teaching in the humanities and the social sciences. Before, we had no collective voice to communicate with administration to even tell them what we wanted. And now ATRAP leadership meets with our provost once a semester. So this is a lot of change for a university to take on in 2 years. If you're on the professional track yourself and you want the university to make changes, listen closely. You must form a collective voice. You must unite professional track faculty at the school and university levels to advocate for change. It's important because you need to identify the issues that you have in common. A university policy is probably not going to change for one person, but if there's a group of you who get together and you all want the same thing, change is possible. So next I'm going to go over some things that you should expect or ask for. You should expect representation on all university and school committees that do not relate to tenure. As these committees are formed on your campus, they're probably creating new policies or maybe revising old ones. If professional track faculty are not represented on those committees, you're going to be left out of the conversation. And if those people are not asking professional track faculty to join those committees, you have to ask to be on them. All policies and benefits should be commensurate with what tenure track faculty receive. You should expect attendance and representation at faculty meetings and faculty governance bodies. So this again is important so that you know what's going on, that you can contribute, and often they're discussing things that are important to your job, like curriculum. Funding for professional development. You should expect a private office space where you can meet with students, a work computer that's less than 5 years old, and access to teaching resources. Funny, huh? And access to teaching resources. So this is full access to your teaching center as well as using teaching assistants. If you've been at your job a while, you should expect a multi-year job contract for more job security. And if you're not receiving at least a 2% annual raise, you're probably experiencing wage compression where the growth in your salary is not keeping up with the cost of inflation, and that's a real issue. New professional track faculty should have access to orientation and mentorship. And the last one is that you should ask for annual performance reviews. Now, this may seem like something that you really don't want, but I'm here to tell you that if it's done right, it can be used in your advantage, to your advantage in a few ways. One, it facilitates communication with your boss, because then he or she will actually know what you're doing. Two, it can promote a conversation about goal setting and the resources you need to do your job better. And three, it can provide documentation for when it's time to go up for promotion. So I love my job and where I work, especially after all these policy changes. It showed me that the university does value what I do, and they care about the education we provide to students, and that they want to do the right thing. I've been helping lead ATROP for the past 2 years, and I currently serve as its co-president. There are a few things that we're still working on, so we're still working on creating an orientation specifically for professional track faculty, and we're working on policies as they relate to phased retirement and then a paid professional development leave, which would be like a sabbatical. And we're working with administration to make those things happen. So I urge all of the professional track faculty in the audience to form your collective voice. For those of you who are tenured on the tenure track or administrators, we need your voice too. We need you to support professional track faculty and advocate for change, because professional track faculty are fulfilling a major mission of a university, and that's to teach and to mentor students. With that, I would love to take some, oh, there's one more slide. A thank you slide. I want to thank all the people on this slide here. They had an instrumental role in helping create these policy changes. I obviously did not do this alone, so I'd like to thank them. And if you would like to access our school's white paper, a shortened URL is shown on this slide. And with that, I would love to take some questions. So if you'd like to ask a question, please come up to a mic. Yes.
I'm David Zietlow with Bradley University. I think you're not thinking big enough. There should be a revision of the policies for tenure so that someone who's on a professional track can actually attain tenure. So I think we need a revolution in the tenure process. Mm-hmm. I'm a tenured full professor, but I sacrificed my teaching early in my career to get the publications. And I think if we really value teaching, we should change the tenure policies.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. You know, there have been studies that have basically surveyed administrators, deans, faculty at several institutions. And the problem with that is they found out that there is no commonality, that the opinions on this are so divergent that ideally, yes, but realistically, getting all those people in a room to agree is going to be very challenging. Yeah.
Yeah. I certainly think that there is no real difference left now between the non-tenured and tenure track, in my mind, the way you are proposing. And I also want to make sure that tenured faculty is not considered non-professional faculty.
It's not considered, right. You know, we were discussing this earlier, that there's not really a perfect term for professional track faculty. It's always a challenge, but you're right. Increasingly, professional track faculty are fulfilling some of the same roles as tenure track faculty. Yeah. Anyone else? Okay.
Yes, my name's Tom Roberts, retired from Kansas State University. I have a question. You referred to you got your PhD, but you did not mention the professional engineer license, which also designates professionalism. And I think a lot of professors are licensed, but don't necessarily have PhDs. Might you comment on that, please?
So that goes back to our selection of the term professional track faculty?
Do you have anything to say about that?
Sorry, I guess I didn't fully understand that. I'm not personally a licensed professional engineer.
I missed your question, I'm sorry.
I guess, could you restate the question?
A licensed professional engineer is qualified to practice the profession of engineering, mm-hmm. and that's different than a PhD, but some would say it has the same qualification, particularly when it comes to being a professor of professional practice at a university. And I wondered if your group had considered the PhD versus the professional engineer or the PE as a part of your inclusion in this professional track.
No, we had not considered that. Any other questions?
Hello, I want to speak up for the professional tracks. Uh-huh. I'm at Purdue University. I had my PE first and got my PhD later, and now teaching professional track. And the big question, we got a lot of those things that you have, you know, already, but the big issue was promotions. So to get promotion as professional track, you essentially have to do the same things that the tenure track people have to do. But so that's the big issue I see. But one thing I want to comment on was at one point my supervisor asked me if I wanted to convert to tenure track, and I said, why in the world would I want to do that? It's the most bizarre system I've ever seen in the world. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, so that's an interesting point. In our promotion guidelines, as I mentioned, we have kind of more of an unbundling of what our professional track faculty do. Either you're more focused on research or you're more focused on teaching. And so the teaching criteria, the promotion criteria for that position is more heavily rely on probably service basically contributions to the school, your professional society affiliations, not really research. So they do take into account engineering education research, but not domain research. So that's something that we have done differently, I guess.
Hi, my name is Dr. Christine Grant. I'm Associate Dean of Faculty Advancement over here to your left.
Oh, over here to the thank left. You.
And I just wanted to, I appreciate all the comments, and I just wanted to say I think you all have done a fantastic job with this. We have assistant, associate, and full teaching faculty at NC State. We have the track, and they go through the same process. In terms of the RPT, they get vetted by their department and the college and the university committee in order to be promoted. So we're going to be talking about that Wednesday morning. But I just wanted to say thank you very much for mm-hmm. bringing this information to us. And I hope that more universities will take the model that you're using and try to adapt it within the context of what's going on their campus with regards to the provost office, because that's instrumental in terms of policy. But I hope that you'll be able to package it and more universities will be able to learn from what you've done. So thank
right.
you.
So speaking of which, Janie, Bryn, and I are leading a workshop on this topic if you'd like to hear more. It's right after the plenary in the back of the exhibit hall. It's by the food buffet, so you can't miss us. So if you'd like to hear more, we'll be there. And I think that's all the time we have. Is that right? All right, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Boyd, for sharing your experiences with us. And now I'd like to close the plenary session and wish everyone a wonderful conference.
Thanks again to all of our ASC members and their ladies and gentlemen, look at this. Former ASC President
Louis
Martin Vega and his wonderful wife, Maggie, You run into ASCE members all over the world. Hope you guys have a very nice visit. Thanks a lot, everybody.
It's great. Take care.
No sé qué hacer, te ves muy bien, me acercaré.